Makaurau and welcome to We Read Auckland's Conversations with Auckland Authors. My name's Ineka Vogels. I'm a reading engagement specialist at Auckland Libraries and I'm one of the hosts of our Books and Beyond podcast. Today I'm really delighted to be sitting down for a kōrero, remotely as you can see, with our Auckland authors Fiona Sussman and Patricia Bell. We'll be talking today about their most recently published books, Addressed to Greta, and the Library of Unfinished Business. And we'll be talking a little bit about a theme that both books share, and that's the theme of starting over. And if we have some time at the end, we're going to also delve a bit into their reading lives, if they don't mind. So I'm going to kick it off with just a quick introduction for you. Fiona Sussman here is an award-winning author and she's a former GP. She was originally from South Africa, but she's lived and worked in Auckland for over 30 years. Now, she's also known for her short stories, and her 2016 book, The Last Time We Spoke, won the Nio Marsh Award for Best Crime Novel. An Address to Greta that we'll be discussing today was published by Bateman Books in 2020, and it won the New Zealand Book Lovers Fiction Award in 2021. Tēnā koe, Fiona. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Kia ora koutou. It's lovely to be here. A real treat to meet you and Patricia, not quite in person, but nearly, and to be part of.
We tried, didn't we?
We did. Really cool.
I'm sure the audience will understand. And Patricia Bell is an author, writer, editor, and proofreader. Busy lady. She was born in Northern Ireland and her family moved to Auckland when she was 5 years old, so I think we can call her a local now. Now, alongside her work supporting other writers, she's had many short stories, poems and articles published, and she recently won the 2021 Graham Lay Short Story Competition with her piece Dandelion Clocks. Now, her debut novel was published just this year in March 2022. It's called The Library of Unfinished Business, and it was released by Cloud Ink Press. Congratulations on your first book, Patricia. And no mai haeremai. We're so happy to have you here.
Morena, thank you so much. What a joy to join Fiona and you, not in person, but at least we're here and we can talk.
That's
books.
Right.
And what a wonderful thing to do on a rainy, miserable day.
I'm so looking forward to it. Well, look, for those of our viewers who haven't yet read Addressed to Greta and the Library of Unfinished Business, and I sincerely hope that they all go out and change that up right away, if so, I wondered if you could each give us a quick rundown of what these books are about. And we'll start with you, Fiona.
Well, Addressed to Greta is really the story of Greta Gillings. She's a rather awkward, socially anxious 30-something-year-old who has lived a very constrained, safe life and has spent so much time trying to be the Greta other people would like her to be that she no longer really knows who she is anymore. She's forever constrained by her mother, what her mother would have said and done. One of her mother's favourite mantras is no expectation, no disappointment, and it serves Greta well. And her life is really turned upside down when a dear and probably her only good friend dies, and he leaves her in his will a gift, a rather unusual bequest. On the surface of it, it's just an all expenses paid holiday, which sounds amazing, but there is a catch, and the catch is that the period of time Greta will be away is of indeterminate. She doesn't know how long she'll be away for. And similarly, the destinations and the whole itinerary will remain a mystery and will only be revealed to Greta on the eve of her departure to East Destination. And so inherent in that gift is uncertainty. And what it demands of Greta to take advantage of it is to really cast off the shackles of this very safe life she's led. And in the process, hopefully, it becomes a gateway to self-discovery and finding out the true Greta.
I can tell you've done this before, Fiona. That was a great, great summary.
Thank you.
Patricia, how about the Library of Unfinished Business?
Yes, well, so the Library of Unfinished Business tells the story of a disillusioned, unhappy, small-town librarian, Morris, who dies one Monday morning in a car crash, and that's not a spoiler because it happens on page one. And he finds himself in a very strange heaven, one that nobody expects. And it tells us about his adventures there and the things that happen, because it appears that his heaven is on the brink of revolution. And in the meantime, we hear about the adventures of Morris's daughter, Andy, on Earth. And she's never got on well with her father. And when her father dies, she struggles. And so she starts writing a series of letters to him, not only to try in her own way to connect with some aspect of her father, but to try and understand her relationship with him and what's happened in her family. And at one point, very strangely and unexpectedly, their two paths intersect. And Morris has to make some very tough decisions. How is he going to save himself, and how is he going to save his daughter? And the decisions he makes will determine whether this heaven is the one he deserves or the one that he desires. And at the heart of it, it's the story of a father and a daughter, but it's also about, I wanted to write about the power of storytelling, and also the chance that we all have at redemption, second chances, and ultimately the power of love to conquer all things, which sounds a bit Pollyanna-ish, but actually, I hope it works.
It does work. Yes, it does work. And it's interesting you should talk about second chances, because I definitely see that coming through in both of the books. Both characters get a second chance. Now, when we first meet our main characters, you know, both Greta and Morris, they're surviving, but they're not really thriving, are they? Oh, I have to say, Patricia, of course, Morris doesn't survive for long. You kill him off pretty quickly. But I noticed that with both characters, you know, because we get to see how they've gotten to this situation. You know, they've both got quite sad and lonely people in many ways. But that comes out in quite different ways for both of them. Yeah, for Fiona, you know, I felt Greta was, you know, she's quite a people pleaser, and she tries to fade into the background so much in her life. And Morris, by contrast, he's quite prickly, and he's a bit passive aggressive. Yeah, he's a bit of a prickly pear. So I wondered if we could have a chat about, you know, all the lonely people. This is, it's a common issue, isn't it? Loneliness is an epidemic, they say. And I thought we might start with Patricia.
Sure. So it's interesting, when I wrote Morris, I obviously used humour, and perhaps we'll talk a bit about that a bit later. But when I wrote him, I wanted to not only write an amusing story and one that would engage interest, I also wanted to create a character who had layers, and I wanted to look at this whole issue of the things that we do to protect ourselves. Because Morris is a complicated character, and at first when we meet him, he's full of passive aggressiveness, and he hides things under a prickly humour. But I wanted to, as the story went on, and as I carefully fed out little bits of his background, I wanted to make it obvious that he'd had a really hard upbringing, and his parents had played a huge part in shaping the person he was. And as most of us do, he took on the mantle of some negative characteristics as a way to protect himself. And don't we all do that? And so he arrives in heaven lonely and pushing people away. And the question that arises is he going to be able to break through that? Because we all need to do that in order to connect with other people. It's the only way that we can connect. And, of course, that's very frightening for Morris. And so the challenge is not just, will he be able to save himself and save his daughter? It's, will he be able to save the things inside of himself? Will he be able to save himself from loneliness? Will he be able to save himself from self-hatred? And the same goes, I think, for his daughter, Andy, who is exceptionally lonely because she's an 18-year-old and she's not like most 18-year-olds. She's a teenage girl who's very intellectual. She listens to 80s music. She doesn't have a lot of friends. And how can she find a way to connect with her dead father, but with the rest of her family, in a way that helps her get through this awful period of grief, this awful period of mourning? And I think so it did raise issues for me around loneliness and the ultimate importance of connection. And I hope that what I tried to do was suggest that what we need to do is try to connect now, to tell the people we love them now, to reach out to people now before it's too late. And of course, Morris gets a second chance even when he's in heaven. And I'm not going to present too many spoilers, but he manages to redeem himself. And I think there's a real message of hope in there. But I don't know how Fiona feels, but I do worry for young people that we all think we're connected, but in fact we're less connected than ever. And I worry for my 15-year-old daughter. And I could go on about social media for a long time, but I won't. I'll throw it to Fiona because I'm sure she's got a lot to say because of her wonderful character and the things she discovers about
Patricia,
loneliness.
Patricia, I think you've really sort of hit the nail on the head there, because I guess in all my books, I've always been kind of quite fascinated by those people who are forced to navigate the periphery, that they don't quite fit in. You know, there's this kind of bell curve of the norm, and it doesn't matter whether it's your race or your sexuality or, you know, whether you are more studious or not, but I think a lot of lonely people just feel that they don't fit in. And more than ever, I think, with social media now, we have, ironically, we're meant to be more connected. And yet what we're finding is that it's such a false connection, because people curate who they present themselves as. And so for the person looking on social media, that disconnect between the life they have and the life other people have seems even more enormous and vast. And I think in my book, what Walter tries to do, which is the beauty of travel, is that when people travel far afield, they meet people that they're unlikely to ever meet again. And so they are almost more honest with who they are. And Greta finds the same thing, is that people often share details about their own flaws and intimate details that one wouldn't share with people in one's immediate environment, because one wants to present the best. I mean, I know even myself, when I have a Facebook writer's page, you know, I've got two pictures to present, and the one makes me look happier and better and more involved, I'm likely to put that on. And I remember listening to John Boyne speaking, I think, at one of the writers' festivals, and saying how even writers' success is often presented as just, you know, this amazing thing that I wrote this book and it was a bestseller. Mm. But he described a period of depression he suffered from. And I think things like this are so important in bringing people together and actually realizing, which is what books also afford, that commonality of feeling that we all a lot of people feel just the same way. And I think the loneliness that we have, we all live in our homes as well. We now retreat in our homes with COVID, especially. We don't even go to cinemas anymore. We do everything in our home and we venture out very rarely. And those skills we have in being social become a bit like a muscle. We lose some agility, and so when we do then interact with people, we're actually a little more awkward, and so we retreat and we interact even less. And so I think it's a tricky thing, this loneliness. And I think it is, as Patricia, what I loved with that message that comes through in your book, Patricia, it's about dealing with the here and now and connecting with people now and telling them how you feel.
I was just going to say about, you're so right about the importance too of story. And I remember reading Charlotte Grimshaw's memoir where she said the importance, the existential importance of telling your story can set you free and create connections, and not the carefully curated story we see on social media. But I hope that partly what my book addressed too was the importance of telling your story and sharing your story and the importance of storytelling. The storytellers are so important because it connects us and it helps us go, yes, I feel that too. And it creates
you, and you find your tribe almost, exactly.
Yes. And it reflects a shared humanity. And I really wanted to give that message too, that the storytellers are more important than ever now, but the true storytellers, not the airbrushed storytellers, if we can be brave enough.
Exactly. Yeah. I think that's it. I mean, the message with Greta was having the courage to be seen in order to live a bigger life. And that's very hard sometimes, because we're so seeking approval that we kind of, it's just too hard to present us ourselves, you know, warts and all, and say, this is who I am, this is what I believe.
And that's what Morris struggles with, but in the end he does it and he is accepted. And what a revelation that is to him. Sorry. Next question.
Oh no, I could listen to the answers to that question for actually a lot longer, but we will move on, and I'll bring it back to because you both mentioned the strong influence of parents and maybe how this helped to contribute to the small lives, really quite small lives, that that Morris and Andy and Greta were living, and really their parents had a big part to play in that. I'm going to quote Philip Larkin's very famous poem. The first line, of course, is the most famous, but I will sanitize it slightly for you. His poem, This Be the Verse, famously starts with the line, "They F you up, your mum and dad. They may not mean to, but they do." So I thought we would perhaps have a little chat about your main characters and how they get a little bit effed up by the parents.
Indeed.
And I think we'll start with Fiona this time.
Yes, Ineka. Well, Greta, her mother, I think probably just to peel it back a bit and say that we all have this assumption that parents, they're adults and they come to the job equipped to do it well. And really, parents bring their own insecurities and complexities and the fact that they in fact have been raised by parents who have flaws. Greta's mother has lived a life of disappointment and shame. And so for her, especially from the era she comes from, her main drive is to be seen to live a respectable life. And so she really passes this sort of legacy on to Greta and her legacy of disappointment and negativity. And so Greta lives this very safe, small life where really what is paramount is that she finds approval from others. But as a result, that it's, you know, her true character is not really allowed to develop. And I think with parenting, you know, it's such a formative a time when a child is really forming as a character, that your most important relationship is with parents. And I think that if parents place excessive expectation on a child about this is how you should behave or this is how I want you to be, the child is frequently going to disappoint and frequently feel like they don't measure up. And ideally, that sort of, you know, for Greta, she doesn't really, her tastes are her mother's tastes, her, you know, risk-averse behavior is her mother's risk-averse behavior. And so she no longer has really any connection. In many ways, she's living a lie, a little bit like Morris, Patricia's Morris, living, there's a real disconnect between what who they really are. And I think that what we forget is that actually somebody integral and, you know, a seminal person such as a friend or such as a teacher can also, if they have a belief in that the child, actually offer the child the opportunity to grow. And that's where Walter comes in, and I guess Aunt Fleur in Patricia's book. Act as facilitators and enablers. And I don't want to go on forever and ever, but I do remember reading this about this supposedly very, very happy community or tribe in South America. And the researchers found that the mothers were often, they were very central to the child's life, but they allowed the child the freedom to just develop as the child wanted to. So the child might get into a scrap or head off and play with kids and come back with a sore knee or in tears because of a fight. And the mother would continue what she was doing, not even really pay the child much attention, except scoop them up and offer them the comfort of just being there. And then after a while, the kid would wriggle away and head off again to solve the problems of the world on their own. And I think ideally it's parenting allowing the child that's born, not the child you want to have been born to develop.
Yeah, that's very beautiful. And I think, yes, absolutely. Morris, Patricia, sort of closes down quite a lot, doesn't he? You know, he's described as being sort of half-cocked and a bit ambivalent, or certainly from Andy's perspective, but that's a product of his fear, really, would you say?
Morris grew up with a very cruel, harsh father and quite a manipulative mother who also struggled with depression. Now, I didn't write all of this into the book. This was a backstory that I had. I wrote screeds and screeds of backstory about all of Morris's family, and just some of it made it into the exposition in the novel. But because I knew his background so intimately, it helped me write him. And so hopefully I demonstrated through his behavior and his developmental arc the things that he had struggled with. But I think he always struggled to put a stake in the ground because he was scared to, because that would mean commitment. That would mean committing himself to a particular course, and therefore that meant the risk of failure. And so he was terrified. And I think a lot of us can resonate with that. And I'm not going to introduce any spoilers, but the challenge for Morris is, am I going to shake off the shackles of some of the difficulties I had when I was growing up? And am I going to be able to put my stake in the ground? Because if I don't, will my daughter ever be able to? How can I show my daughter the way to live, even though I'm dead? And so we see his struggle in coming to terms with this. And you'll see throughout the novel, he talks about various incidents with his parents that are very telling, I think. And then you also see, interestingly enough, you see Andy's point of view. You see his daughter's point of view and her own upbringing with a very overwhelming mother and a very distant father. And how does she manage herself? How does she come to terms with her family history? And certainly, as Fiona was mentioning, she has an auntie who's a close female figure and someone she can look up to who assists her. But what I hope comes across in my book at the end is that despite these struggles, because every family has hurts and griefs and secrets and disappointments and chasms, but there's always hope. There's always hope that we can still make some sort of reparation and build some bridges. It's never too late, no matter what. And I have to say, after I wrote the book, I looked at it again and I thought, oh my goodness, and my own experience resonated a little bit. I grew up in a family with a very, quite a distant father and quite an overwhelming mother. And some of the things I dealt with were actually reflected in the book that I had written. But isn't that the way sometimes language heals us, right? Without us realizing, and the way stories heal us, we work through these things in our own way. And my mother died on Christmas Eve last year, just as I was preparing to publish this book. And that brought an extra layer of richness, actually, to what I was doing, because near the end, there was nothing but love and healing and a poignant beauty to that sadness. And it overlaid every interview that I did as I was publishing my book. And it just reinforced to me again, it's never too late to heal. Without being too unrealistic, believe me, I know there is hard work. There is sometimes therapy. There are struggles. But it's never too late to search for that redemption. That's the joyous thing about being human. There's always the capacity for forgiveness, I think, if we are brave enough to exercise it.
Patricia, you make me think there's the most lovely French saying, which says, tu comprends, c'est tu pardonner, which is, to understand is to forgive. And I think part of the growth of all our characters and ourselves is the release to understand your parents' flaws and then have a release from it. And sometimes when you understand where their behaviors come from, it is easier then for you to grow. I think it's holding on to those things with resentment that can actually impede growth as well.
I completely agree. And it's when Andy finally understands her family history, that is when she can forgive. That is when she can come closer to both her mother and her father. I'm not saying it's easy. You know, we don't live in this la-la land, but the understanding brings healing. And I firmly believe that. And that's another message I wanted to try and bring. But of course, then you become a parent yourself and you realize all the things
all those out the window.
You have about parenting just goes out the window.
Exactly.
And all you can do is cross your fingers and hold on for the wild ride.
Absolutely.
Well, that is so true. I love the description of it as a wild ride. It certainly is. I'm glad we're laughing because both of these books, you know, they do deal with some really heavy subjects, but you've both got a really fine touch with the humour and the empathy that comes through that helps to kind of balance that, the dark and the light in the books. I wondered how you know when you've got that mixture right. Maybe we'll start with you, Patricia.
Oh, golly, do you ever? Because, you know, I love to laugh. One of my favorite pastimes, but sometimes what I might find is snortingly funny, you know, just causes a raised eyebrow or a pursed lip, and so it's difficult to know if things are going to land or not. I think, interestingly enough, if you look at my collection of short stories and things I've written, there's a lot of melancholy there. There are slices of, I often address things like death and grief and loss, and yet in this novel the humor was quite predominant, and I rejoiced in that. I didn't try too hard. I didn't try to be funny, but hopefully I was, and I think that's partly the secret. but interestingly enough, I'm proofreading a manuscript at the moment. As you know, I'm an editor, a proofreader, and I'm working with a comedian, and this comedian has written a book, and I'm having to do a lot of work with this incredible comedian because some of the jokes that would be wonderful in a live venue don't land quite the same on the page. And so you never quite know. And I guess my only thing was I loved my characters. I adored my story. I laughed while I was writing it. And I think if you don't try too hard and it simply comes from the place inside you that enjoys humour, and that is in love with the writing process. And it plays, you know, some writers are so serious, and I get that it's serious business, but also it's play. For me, it's play. And to publish this book, which has important messages, I hope, but also just brings people so much joy, is it's wonderful to me because I played, and I would like readers to be able to play because, oh, my goodness, don't we need that right now? Oh. Not only the hope, and the messages of hope, but just the ability to let go and laugh and see that we're funny. Oh, my goodness, aren't humans funny? As a writer, if you observe keenly, part of our job is to observe keenly. And if you can do that and then use your gift with language to record that in a way that might be slightly different and quirky and off-center, then I think that's a real gift, and I hope that most of my jokes land. I had to pull back. I had to cut some. They were awful.
Well, it sounds like you had a lot of fun writing it, Patricia, and certainly it does spring off the page. For me, yes. I was laughing as I was reading, and similarly for you, Fiona, you know, Greta and her chickens and her amazing trip to the shoe store for larger feet.
Well, it came as a much of a surprise to me, and I think my subconscious must have been working. I think my kids had begged me for so long to write a happy book that, you know, when I started writing Greta, there was a point of awareness where I suddenly was like, oh, is this funny? And then, you know, I almost became self-conscious, and so I thought, oh, this is going to become contrived. So I just thought, Greta's unwittingly funny, so I'm just going to slip back into her skin and see the world through her eyes. And I think, to be honest, I mean, humor lets us cope in the current world, doesn't it? Humor offsets the deeper issues in writing as well. And I think that, I mean, I know Jacques Brujan, who said he wrote Krishna's Diary, and that he said he likes to open his audience's mouth wide in laughter and then slip something serious in. And I think there's that idea of your reader dropping their guard and just enjoying the humor, and then maybe being a bit more open to some of the serious issues at hand, because none of us can really live in a state of absolute seriousness all the time. And so that humour allows us to come to the surface of it. And certainly Greta, and I think what Patricia's talking about there, having fun writing, I just had so much fun writing Greta. And it was a very new experience for me. I mean, I love writing my books, but it was such a different book to what I've written before. But there was a real energy just coming out of the characters. And I think, Yeah, I think as long as you don't try too hard with humour, and you do have to accept that sometimes your humour is going to, there are different tastes in humour, and, you know, different countries have different humour, but it was a lot of fun. I really, yeah, when Greta takes her first plane trip, that's when I kind of realised, oh, yes, things are, you know, Greta is quite a humorous character.
Yeah, I loved reading Greta's story, and I can say my parents really loved it too. They've been passing it around their friends. So Patricia, your one's going around next.
Oh, wonderful.
Well, I wanted to have a chat to you both about letters in your book, because for both of your stories, letters that kind of reach beyond the grave are really integral to the plot development and to the way the characters interact with each other. So I wanted to talk to you, Fiona, first, and ask, you know, why did you bring letter writing into the mix, and what did it bring to the story of Greta and Walter?
Well, I think it was a very useful device for me. I think the first real problem or challenge I had was that Walter plays such an important part in Greta's life, and his influence is huge, and yet when the book opens, he is already dead, and I wanted him to be brought alive to my readers. And so instead of having flashbacks, or it was a wonderful device where Walter's story would come through in the letters, and so from the grave, letters were allowing me to sort of, you know, transcend timelines. I think there's also a real honesty that comes in letter writing. You're not thinking about how the person you're talking to is going to respond. There's often a greater intimacy. And so the letters really offered the reader, I hope, a real insight into who Walter was. Unfortunately, any letter from the grave is as I think Greta bemoans at one point, it's a unilateral discussion. So sometimes the frustration is not being then able to respond. But I think that what it offers, the letters offer Greta, is something she can hold on to, that words that aren't just spoken and disappear, she can read them, she can reread them, there's something concrete about them. And it makes me think of when I used to take my kids to school and home, you know, when they were at home and we were at dinner and I'd say, how was your day? They'd just be like a grunt, yeah, fine. But when we were driving and the focus was removed from them and that we were just looking out, and that's when often so many revealing, intimate discussions would occur. And I feel like that's what sometimes letters offer. When the focus is off, you're not having someone immediately in front of you listening, you often share some amazing insights. And for me, letters played a really important role. And the letters that Greta subsequently gets from her father also allow her to look back in history. And I think as a device, it's a lot easier than having all this information coming out of character's head. It can almost become like an information dump. Whereas an actual literary device, it's fantastic because you can actually put quite a bit of information in a letter without it sounding too artificial or contrived. Whereas if a character is thinking all of that, it can become a little bit heavy.
And Patricia, the letters in your book do kind of cross rounds a little bit. Would you like to have a chat about letters in the Library of Unfinished Business?
Yes, I mean, so much of what Fiona just said resonated. And it's interesting that in her book, the letters come from beyond the grave. But in my book, it's more that Andrea writes letters and they go beyond the grave.
Yes.
And I don't want to, again, give many spoilers, but things happen to them when they go beyond the grave. But it's ironic that I wrote a book using letters as a literary device, because I used to say to my book club, I'm not reading any book with letters in it. I can't stand epistolary novels. I'm just and here I am.
Never say never.
I know. And then I write a novel that uses letters. But as Fiona has said, it's such a useful device. It allows characters to reveal more than they would. I think it's a way to reveal yourself, but in a way that slightly protects yourself. Andy writes these letters. It's things she may never have been able to say to her father in person, but she was able to put them on paper. And I think as writers, sometimes we can understand that, that we can write things sometimes much better than we can say them. And so for me, it was a wonderful device for Andy to pour out her heart, but also it was a way for me to show that not only are letters a static form of communication, they can aid in our growth. They can communicate with other people. They can change and evolve. You can see Andy's character arc and her understanding grow as she writes these letters. And I also wanted to reinforce just the strength of the power of words, because the whole book is about the power of story. And so letters were one way for me to reinforce that. It was a way of communication and a way to tell my readers it's never too late to communicate, even if you have to write it on paper at one remove. It's a way that's it's very intimate and at once less intimate than being face to face. And it's something that lasts the test of time, I think. And so all of that was in it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Well, I really enjoyed your use of letters, both of you. And I actually do like I don't know how to pronounce it properly, epistolary novel. I do enjoy them.
Epistolary something.
I wanted to sort of go back to our theme of starting over and kind of put it to you both. In terms of your writing career, if you had a chance to start over professionally, is there anything, or what, if anything, I should say, would you do differently the second time around? And I'll point that, oh, sorry, I should need to point that, don't I? I'll put that to Patricia first.
Look, I could say many things that I would probably do differently, but I'm going to land on no, because the way things have happened, I've produced this book and I wouldn't change that for the world. It took many years to write this book. It was put away many times. Life intervened, major life changes, launching a business, having a child, all sorts of things intervened. And the richness of the book, I think, is due to the fact that it took so long and I couldn't have written it years ago. And so I'm going to say no. I don't think I would change anything apart from the fact I would probably write more regularly because the more you exercise the muscle, you know, the better it becomes. But ultimately, I'm happy where I'm at. And also at 53, I feel like I'm just getting going. And that's the other thing I wanted to send a message about. I've written lots of short stories and I've got a business, but I'm only just getting going with novel writing. And I'm 53 and I feel like I'm just starting. So it's never too late. And I feel I'm just at that sweet spot, at that right part of my life, when there's more richness to come, hopefully. So I'm going to say no. Life is awesome as it is, and that's okay.
Love it.
I think that's the beauty of writing, isn't it, Patricia? As opposed to so many other professions. In fact, the longer you've lived through things and struggled and the challenges you overcome, it all feeds into your writing. I know that I gave a chat to some final year students a while ago about career choices because I've made this jump in careers. And, you know, looking back with a retrospectoscope, you have this idea of there being a plan and it all looking quite ordered, when in reality, life is messy. And I guess it's mainly just about taking opportunities when they present, if they are right for you. And so I don't think I would, the only thing I would change is when I stopped medicine for a year to step out and be at home and write, I wouldn't have told that many people that I was going to write a book because if you haven't been in it, the weight of expectation, you know, you bump into someone 1 month later and they say, oh, when's the novel coming out? And you want to say, actually, I'm on page 10 of the first draft. It's pretty shoddy. I'm actually going to take 10 years to be formally published. And so having to articulate it the whole time, I started to almost feel like a failure, which is already hard when there's a lot of self-doubt. So I think I would have just shared it with a few close people and just kept plugging away. But I think that that's the other thing, is that it is a long journey and you learn from, my first book was very nearly published early on and then something fell through. And in fact, I was so grateful in retrospect that the deal had fallen through at that point, because the books were, also went into a bottom drawer, life experience, life happened. And in fact, I think the book came out a much better book 10 years later. Yes, I probably wouldn't change much either.
Well, that's very heartening. Thank you for that. I think we do have just a little bit of time left to have a little chat about reading, your reading life, and also I'm going to throw in some questions about libraries. So this is just going to be a little quick fire round for you both. So okay. I will start with you, Fiona, and ask yes. Which is your favourite Auckland library?
Now, that is not a question I can answer because I think New Zealand does libraries so well that I do not have one favourite. I teach workshops up at Hibiscus Coast. I get my local books from Takapuna. I have been to Tomodawa and Devonport. I think, I don't know if it's compared to, maybe it was an era thing, but growing up, libraries were kind of austere, terrifying places where you went to open the Encyclopedia Britannica to do a project. And you just walk into any of the Auckland libraries and there's this wonderfully casual feeling and warmth. There'll be little children's groups, people will be learning a different language or English. There'll be the book you requested on a shelf. There'll be the very modern new libraries like Tāmaki and Devonport, and then the cozy little ones, and I love them all, but I've always thought librarians and gardeners are the best sort of people, so I'm always happy when I go to an Auckland library.
Oh, that's so nice for you to say. How about you, Patricia?
This is an easy one. Remuera Library, because it inspired the library in my book. When I first started the book, I lived in Remuera, and I based Morris's library on Remuera Library. So I actually tried to have my book launched there, but I couldn't because of COVID, but I met with them to arrange to have my book launched there. But wonderfully enough, I'm doing a talk at Remuera Library in August, and that fills me with so much joy because that's where the whole journey began. Yeah.
Lovely.
Oh, fabulous. I'm glad that's happening, Patricia. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Now, I wanted to ask you both, who is an author that you think that more people should read? So someone who you think maybe is flown under the radar and should be more widely appreciated. So I'll start with you, Patricia.
Do you know, I thought about this question and I actually hesitate to recommend particular authors to people because I'm a huge advocate of telling people simply to read what you love and what makes your heart sing rather than thinking you have to read a particular genre or author to feel like you're a real reader. So the only thing I would say, and this is what I try to do, is try and read things if you can, read everything that you love. If you like romance novels, if you like sci-fi, if you like crime, I'm all good with all of that. You don't have to read the Booker winners and the Pulitzer Prize winners to be a reader. Read whatever you love, but try and read unexpectedly sometimes. Go out of your comfort zone, read other genres, read books by people you wouldn't normally consider reading, read nonfiction, read books that perhaps might take you by surprise or you wouldn't normally pick up, simply to expand your mind a little bit. That's what I try to do. But don't feel pressure, because I think people feel this pressure that they have to be reading these kinds of books to be a proper reader and to be intellectual and to go to the Writers' Festival. I have to have read all these books. It's rubbish. Just read what you love. Because what we need are more people who feel enriched by words and by stories that they love. That's what we need. We don't need a whole lot of people walking around feeling self-importantly that they read the latest, you know, prize winner. Just read what you love. That's all I would recommend. But challenge yourself now and then.
Love it.
Love that answer. I might just defer to Patricia on that one. That's a lovely answer. I was just trying to think, and I guess as a writer, but also there's some authors that just sort of speak to you, and two authors that I've always felt, I'm just amazed at the simplicity with which they write, and yet stacked beneath it are these amazingly deep insight into the human condition, you know. And so I love, in fiction, Elizabeth Stroud. I just feel she'll sometimes say something in a way that I just feel, wow, yes, that's exactly how I felt, and she's articulated it so beautifully. And the other one is the Australian writer Helen Garner, who's a journalist and often just writes essays about life, and just so relatable. And so both of them, I think, write quite simply and are just personal favourites of mine. But I couldn't agree more. I love your take on it. And I think that's so right. I think this idea of, it's a little bit like wine tasting or art or anything, if we're intimidated by it. I mean, you know, even getting boys, for example, into reading when there were so few books around for boys, you know, I would get my son car magazines and, you know, certain classic comics, and it doesn't matter what at the time appeals, as long as people are reading and reading what they enjoy. And I think if it becomes a habit, then, and you do, I think, test yourself every now and then and just try things outside of your comfort zone. I couldn't agree more.
Once we are intimidated by literature, we're in trouble. Once we are intimidated by words, by writers, by writing, by books, I think we're in trouble. Mm. Because literature is for everybody. It should be for everybody. And that's, I'm a strong advocate of that. Yeah. But please read my book.
Hang on a minute. That's my book.
Well, I think that is a wonderful place to wrap up our conversation today. And speaking of the books, I'm going to pop them in front of the camera now. Hopefully you'll be able to see. We have The Library of Unfinished Business and we have Address to Greta here. So I want to just wrap it up by saying thank you so much for joining me. I have so enjoyed this chat. It's been a wonderful way to spend a morning. My huge thanks to both of you for sharing your mahi, your pukapuka, your books, and your kōrero with our readers, and being a very special part of Auckland Library's We Read Auckland program for 2022. So a reminder to our viewers, like Fiona and Patricia just said, read their books. You can find them in our Auckland Library's catalogue, and you'll find them there with a host of other incredible Auckland authors' work. You can request and borrow them for free with no late fees with your library card. And of course, we also encourage you to support Fiona and Patricia and all the rest of our local authors here in Tāmaki, Makaurau, Auckland and Aotearoa, New Zealand, by buying their books at your local bookshop. Whenever you can, books make great gifts. They're a great gift for you as well. So make sure you buy those books and spread the word about how much you're enjoying reading local authors' work. So on behalf of Auckland Libraries, I'm going to wrap it up now and say to our viewers, we're so looking forward to welcome you all on your next visit to our libraries, wherever they are, very, very soon. Take care. Thank you so much to our authors, Fiona and Patricia, and ka kite anō.
Kia ora, thank you.